everybody, to the State of KI podcast. This is the inaugural podcast. I haven't hosted or been a part of a podcast since January when I did the interview with Adam Eisgreen. So I welcome you all. I'm your host, LCD. You all know me as Larry as well. And I want to preface this podcast by letting you guys all know that this is not a podcast to kind of, you know, I don't want to use foul language, so I'm going to say crap all over the game or Killer Instinct. This podcast is basically to try to make things better and find out what's wrong, what's going on, and try to get different perspectives, which is why Bass is here. So he can kind of give his perspective as an Evo runner-up. He made top 8 at Evo last year. He's been to almost every KI tournament. He's a top KI player, and so it's great to get those kind of opinions out there. This podcast is to discuss and talk about the game that we're all passionate about, okay? So I'm sure there's going to be lots of discussions in the chat, and so let's try to be as respectful as we possibly can to each other in the chat as well. Don't let things get out of hand. We're all adults here, and we're able to, you know, have good conversations without things getting out of hand. You know, I used this example earlier in my stream. I don't know if a lot of you guys were here, but, you know, a lot of people in FGC, they're like wrestling. You know, they listen to wrestling podcasts, they watch Monday Night Raw, they just love talking and discussing the things that they see on pay-per-views and things like that, and this is no different, right? We all love video games, we all love to make our games better and just talk and discuss about them. That's what we're doing here in this podcast. It's absolutely no different. So I'm going to be asking Bass a variety of questions, not just about KI, but just his experiences overall, and try to understand what that can actually lead to. And you can see on the bottom left-hand side of your screen right now, those are the topics that we're going to be covering. We're going to be talking about the overall state of KI. We're going to be talking about Season 3 and its balance a little bit, talking about the tournament scene, how the community is in terms of growth and other aspects of that as well. And then just, you know, a brief summary about what we can expect for the future or the things that we'd like to see about Killer Instinct, whether it be, you know, a Season 4 or a full-blown sequel. That's the stuff that we're going to be talking about. So let's go ahead and get started here. So the first thing I want to talk about with Bass is the KI World Cup. We all were at the KI World Cup, well, at least most of us were, including you and I, and we were able to play Season 3 early, like before anyone else did. There was a playable build of the season there. We got to see Kim Woo early. We got to see all the new changes like combo breakers and flip out and stagger. What were your initial impressions of all these new system changes going from Season 2 to Season 3, Bass?
Let's see. When it comes to flip out as a game mechanic, I welcomed it. I was like, oh my god, it's a Street Fighter mechanic, basically, that I'm used to, right? So I was like, okay, this is kind of cool. And then I saw some of the characters that got it early on, and I'm like, yo, Jago, a semi-Shoto, not Shoto, with a flip out, that's cool. And then I saw Riptor do it, and I was like, all right, everything is pretty cool. I knew that Thunder was going to be a problem eventually, but, you know, that's me speculating, right? You can't... Everything was to be determined at that point. Stagger, I thought, was kind of cool, because we had Shadow Jago in Season 2. But then I started seeing all these other characters with Stagger, and I'm just like, okay, I guess, right? I can't really form an opinion back then. Combo Breakers... Going back to neutral, I was like, what? No one has an advantage technically. Like, we don't know these things yet, right? It was Season 3 wasn't out yet.
Yeah, you know, it's brand new. We're testing things. Nothing's final yet.
Right.
So.
Right. In theory, it's just like, hey, everything sounds pretty good for now. Then we had combo breakers in the air, launching your opponent full screen, right? That I was iffy about. It's like, oh, but it's a knockdown. I'm like, I get it, but you're full screen. That's, I don't know about that. That was questionable.
I think one of the biggest talked about changes at the World Cup was the new combo breakers and how we were supposed to go immediately back to neutral. And I didn't really have an opinion on this. I think a lot of people were in the same boat. It's like, oh my God, Season 3, we're all so hyped and excited. We don't really care what's happening. We just want to play early, right? So... you know, there's a lot of things that we don't take into consideration during that time, but we're going to talk a little bit about this later about, you know, what we have thoughts of KI Season 3 now. But is there anything like you like to add about your initial impressions of Season 3 as opposed to Season 2?
Let's see. Let's talk about Season 2. Season 2 at first, my first experience with it was the early access beta. And, was already in my hiatus, right? I took a break from KI, from season one to season two. I took like a 2-3 month break. I got hit with the Destiny bug, and I was fixing my life around. It was pretty cool. But I was like, oh shit, that's right, KI. I'm sorry, I'm not supposed to curse. KI, right? Let me see what's up with that. And then I turned on my Xbox, and I downloaded the update, and it was like, boom, Killer Instinct Season 2 Early Access. And I played Spinal, and I noticed that he had a safe counterbreak after a juggle, because in Early Access, if you guys didn't play it, you can break shadow projectiles, and you can also counterbreak. Mm. It was like, whoa, what is this? So I played a match real quick or whatever, and I did a launcher ender shadow skull, and I counterbroke after it. When they didn't break it, I was like, I was safe. It was a safe counterbreak. And then if they broke it, I got a full combo plus a curse plus damage. I turned off the game immediately after that. I'm like, well, I'm going to go ahead and enjoy my break until season two really comes out, because that's crazy. That's crazy. What is this character? And then I was so like, I was so turned off by like air counterbreakers and air breakers. I was like, what is this? Like it's fear of the unknown, right? Like you don't know what you're getting into. So I wasn't ready. And then eventually I came back to KI. My break was over, and I'm like, all right, let's see what's up with this. And I fell in love with Spinal. I was like, oh crap, you know, he has run cancels, and my main character was Guy in Street Fighter 4, and I love run canceling stuff, and it was fun. Pressure, blah, blah, et cetera, et cetera. Season 3, I saw all the new changes coming up, and I was iffy, I'm not gonna lie. Stagger, I didn't know. I was like, I don't know about Stagger. Flip Out was cool. I'm like, hey, that's kind of a Street Fighter-y thingy. Okay. And I was worried. I was scared. I was like, yo, what's up with these new Season 3 characters, right? What are they going to do to the game? So, Season 3 dropped in March. And as soon as I started playing the game and stuff, I was like, yo, okay. I like it. It's kind of cool.
But that kind of leads me to my next question, though. Like, you know, it came out end of March, Season 3 did. And
correct.
There was a lot of speculations about what's going to be changing. Because, you know, what we tested at the KI World Cup obviously wasn't the final build. But, you know, Season 3 has been out for a little over 6 months now, if that's hard to believe for a lot of people. But it's been out a little over six months. And I want to know how your perspective has changed about the game in that time since the World Cup. Because, you know, take Street Fighter V, for example. Though that game hasn't really seen any changes to any characters and won't for, you know, quite some time more, at least until Capcom Pro Tour is over. But our game is constantly changing all the time. But it hasn't changed that much in Season 3 as the changes were in Season 2. Like, we saw massive changes. Like, TJ Combo, he got like a rework in the middle of the season. It was crazy how much changes the game was going through. But Season 3, we haven't seen that. As much. So what is your take about Season 3 as of now since the World Cup?
Okay, here we go. Season 3, at first, I was like, oh man, this game is pretty damn awesome. You know, I like what they're doing. I like it. Progressively, over the months, new characters came out. People started learning the game more. People started learning the characters more, right? Because, you know, speculation. Oh my god, Glacier's gonna be so broken at the World Cup, and look at him now. It's like, he's alright.
Yeah, I remember talking to, what's his name? Tekken Tim about Glacier at the World Cup. He's like, this character's broken.
People were just like, oh my god, this is so crazy. And then even me, when I saw the Spinal rework, I was like, oh, what? I have Mega Man fireballs, and I'm Morrigan all of a sudden, and holy, you know, everything's awesome. Fast forward to September. We're in September now. It's like, I was totally wrong about everything. And I get it. So, again, everyone's listening to me, right? This is my opinion. You know, no one has to agree. No one has to whatever.
And that's the purpose of this podcast, get different opinions out there.
Everyone's tired of
listening to me, you know?
And then at the same time, you also have to understand that the game is still developing, the game is still growing, and we have a patch coming out confirmed, so who knows what's in it, right? Who knows what's going on? But in the process of everything, they didn't nerf or buff that much throughout Season 3, But the things they chose to adjust were super questionable. It was like, I don't know how I feel about this. I don't. And the more and more I tried to adjust, the more and more I tried to play, the more and more, unfortunately, I started realizing that I stopped having fun. And the flair is still there. KI, yo, you look at the cast, you look at the roster, and you're like, yo, this entire roster is so damn cool. So damn cool. Arbiter's in it, and General Rom, and Thrash, and all these people are really cool, right? But you look at the meta now, and you look at the problem characters, I like to call them, and you're like, man, Kimlu sucks, right? General Rom sucks, right? Hey, I thought Larry's supposed to say that, right?
I didn't say anything. This is all you.
Okay. Now, if someone were to ask me right now, hey, man, which character sucks right now? I would literally be like, nah, I don't think people suck in this game. I don't. And then they're like, really? Okay, so I could pick whoever I want. I'm like, yeah, man, it's a pretty healthy roster. You could pick whoever you want and be successful with them. And then let's say you do pick Kimwoo, right? And you fight against a lovely little robot named Fulgore, or a beautiful Halo alien called Arbiter. Or you play against Jago and you make one mistake and he heals himself to Kingdom Come. You're just like, damn, my character sucks. And it's just like, now, granted, in my opinion, right? No, I don't think Kimwoo sucks. I think Kimwoo's great. She has good buttons, some of the best air-to-airs. She has a good anti-air. She does really damn good damage, you know, just to keep things simple, right? But then when you play against these problem characters, I like to call them, you know, nice term, right? That's when you feel everything turn, right? You feel everything curve, and you're just like, man, my risk reward is so big in comparison to them. What are they really risking here? What are they really rewarding here, right? And it sucks because I think Kim was great. I think General Rom, outside of Mira, they're the two most fun Season 3 characters in my book. I think General Rom is such a cool character, but damn, it's such a struggle if you play against
Ram, other people. I feel like Ram would probably be one of the best characters in Street Fighter. But he's in the wrong game.
Or not even that. Honestly, imagine General Rom in Season 1. Like, you know how scary he would be? It's kind of crazy, right?
Yeah, he would be ridiculous.
Different game, different era.
That's right.
But at the same time, you have to think. Balancing a game is extremely hard,
mm-hmm.
right? Who do you buff? Who do you nerf? Why do you buff? Why do you nerf? Kimwoo is a perfect example. What more can you give this woman? I know how you are, Larry.
No.
Since Season 1.
I love that you say that because I've been saying the same thing for a while now, which is like, she has everything. Why is she so bad, you know?
Exactly. And by the way, I was watching Season 1 today. Top 8 Evo. I was also watching Season 2 today. And I was trying to compare and contrast, see what went wrong, what went right. Season 1, dude, for the people that haven't played that game, Season 1. Dude, after a combo breaker, you got meaty setups for days? Glacius had a true unblockable? It's an interesting game, dude. It was a very different game. Everything has its faults, right? Everything has its faults, and everything has its beauty to it. And Season 3 definitely has that. Season 3 has its beauty. It's there. I can see it. I can smell it.
Let me put it to you this
way.
What do you really love about Season 3, and what do you really hate about Season 3? Or what would, like, changed? And that was one of my next questions.
Okay. Keep it simple. Season 3. The meta right now? That's gotta go. Got guest breaking at its all-time high, because why not? Literally, why not? What is your risk? I was looking at Season 1, and guest breaking, like, manuals and stuff were, like, out of the question. Because, first off, manuals back then were actually a lot harder to do. Season 2 dumbed it down. Probably for the casual players, probably for the community. Season 3 kept that. And season three now is, oh, I'm back to neutral, so why not guest break, right? Which also comes into, like, well, if they keep guest breaking, why won't you counter break? Oh, man, did I just open the door to that one? Hope not.
Calm down,
man. I hope not. No, real talk, though. Counter breakers. Some people say they work. Some people say they don't. I say they're inconsistent. I want to be fair. They work. Are they inconsistent? Yeah, I think so. You mean to tell me that you and I have been playing since season one, and all of a sudden we're mistiming these things? That's a little odd, right? I've been playing gamer LCD for 2-3 years now.
Let's watch it on that gamer stuff.
Come on, man. Hey, man. I'm just saying, you evolved as a person, as a player. All of a sudden, crazy LCD. 2-3 years from now, you're gonna read my break. You know I'm gonna break this right now. Lockout. What? But you read it right. Why are you getting punished for it? That was yours. Why was that robbed from you? I get it. It's fine. So you have things that are inconsistent, and you have characters that reap a lot of rewards with little to no risk in comparison to a bunch of other people. And I feel that should be adjusted. Obviously, we don't know. We have a patch coming. We don't know when. Maybe the definitive edition. Maybe not.
Maybe a couple weeks.
But hopefully, maybe a couple of weeks. Maybe next month. Maybe the World Cup. Who knows, right? But it's really what it is, you know. Unfortunately, some characters struggle a lot now. Some characters don't. And I get it. I understand. I get that. Certain matchups are supposed to be hard. Some certain matchups are supposed to be, you know, a little easy, things like that. And looking at the game now, the worst matchup is probably a 6-4, right? It's still there. It's not like, you know, a 9-1 or an 8-2 or anything crazy. Because, you know, I've played fighting games my whole life, dude. This isn't my first fighting game. It's not. You know, CVS2 was crazy. Marvel 2 was crazy. Super Turbo was crazy. We get it. We understand. But right now, some of these 6-4s, they don't really feel like 6-4s anymore, do they? You play a certain character, certain player even, but a certain character, and you're just like, damn.
I'm probably one of the few that definitely thinks there are maybe some 7-3s in KI. But that's just me.
I refuse to believe that because, you know, again, I watch people play, and I'm just like, it's not that bad. But then you see, like, player tendencies and what the character reaps and what the character can risk. And it's just like, okay, I can see why you may not think it's a 6-4, but I do think it's a 6-4. I think it's a 4-6, right? Things like that.
That's fine.
Right. I think the meta right now is pretty stale, pretty boring. Like, even for spectators. Spectators are getting bored watching the game, and it breaks my heart, dude. It does, because I love this game.
I think I do. I like that you bring that up, because I actually was talking to somebody at an event where he was watching Killer Instinct, and he said that he kind of got bored of watching people do combo breaker, combo breaker, combo breaker.
Mm-hmm. It's a common thing.
Yeah, because there's a lot of guest breaking going on. People are just breaking stuff because they can, and it's like, that's not fun to watch, right? That's just something that I've experienced talking with people outside of the community. I don't know what they can do about that, but that's just something that I wanted to address when you brought up that point about it's not fun to watch.
No, of course. Even towards the end of season two, that was a problem. That is something I did address. They're like, hey, is there anything you don't like about season two? I'm like, yeah, people guest break all the time now in comparison to, like, season one. And it is hard. It's hard to, like, punish that, right? How do you punish someone who guest broke wrong or guest broke right, right? There's so many things that, you know, can you really fix this, ultimately? One of my things, because I'm an old-school gamer, right? I'm like, hey, how about you just bring back inputs? Why don't you bring back an input to, like, hey, you wanna break a combo and it's a light? All right, so you have to do, like, a dragon punch motion light. Is someone going to say, well, that's too hard? I'm like, hey, KI 1 and 2 had it. Pretty sure KI 3 can do it. If you're playing a fighting game, I'm sure you could do a dragon punch motion or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, you know, and the way things are now, of course guest breaking is at an all-time high. You go back to neutral, that means you guys are okay again. And then there's the characters. Like, what's a good example here? Let's say, I don't know. Let's say Gargos, right? Let's say Gargos has meter. He has one bar. And he, you try and counter break, or you try and guest break wrong or something, or whatever. And you get locked down. He's like, I'm going to hit you now. And he does his damage ender, which does a hard knockdown, by the way. It's a little ridiculous. And bam, free minion, because he has meter. It's like, damn, was it really risking that? Was it? It wasn't. And now he's at full screen with a minion, and you're at hard knockdown.
Keep in mind, we have no idea what's coming in this patch that's coming up. It's supposed to be
Of course. Yeah. Right. Like, again, I fear of the unknown, right? Is this the last patch? We don't know. Maybe there's something more after that. But is this going to make or break KI right now? Maybe. Maybe not. Who knows? It's a scary thought, right? What if my problems with Season 3, or what if your problems with Season 3 don't get resolved? And they're like, oh, we're gonna keep this way, but we're going to put this in. And then you're just like, damn, I got to hold that. I got to adjust. Mm-hmm. It's a scary thought. It is. But do I think the magic is still there? Do I think the magic of KI is still there? Of course it is. The game is still relatively fun to play because of such a beautiful roster. The roster is very, very fun, right?
That's one of KI's biggest compliments I've heard from many people, is that
multiple
diverse.
Right. And me personally, I go to all these majors, and I'm not just some KI guy. I've played Street Fighter V at every major I've gone to this year. And people know me from Killer Instinct. People know me from other stuff, from being friends with other people and things like that. And they ask me, hey, how's KI? Or, hey, I've always wanted to play that game. Tell me how you feel about it. Or, hey, how is it different from Street Fighter? And I'm just like, it's not. If it basically feels the same way, it moves the same way, it's a 2D fighter, there's 6 buttons, it's pretty damn good. Mm-hmm. It's actually maybe a little easier, maybe a little harder, who knows? You just got to get used to some of the characters. And then, you know, talking about Season 3, just recently, perfect. East Coast Throwdown. I was like a game away from top 32 Street Fighter V. I'm like, what? I don't even play this game. It's kind of crazy. And eventually, the guys in my pool were like, hey, weren't you the guy at EVO? And I'm like, yeah, it's me. I'm the bone guy. and then we talked. Because they asked me. They're like, oh, I've always wanted to play KI, but I didn't want to buy an Xbox. And I'm just like, there's PC version. They're like, oh, really? Like, tell me about the game. And I'm like, the game's pretty cool. Everyone in the game is relatively good for the most part, except for some. Some need to get toned down.
Kimu?
That's definitely not Kim Woo. I think Kim Woo's great. I think Kim Woo's fine as is. I mean, what else are you going to give her, right? Well, she can helicopter away with her nunchucks to avoid mix-ups. Like, no. Like,
give her a bookie fine. Parachute. She'll be good.
Oh, God. Here we go.
I'm kidding.
Right. So now let's dive into the mindset of other fighting game players that do not play Killer Instinct, that do not know what Killer Instinct is. I described Jago to them because most of my pool played Ken and Ryu, right? So I was like, Jago is a semi-Shoto, right? He has some of the best buttons in the game. He has some of the best pressure in the game. He has great meterless damage. He can build his own V-trigger / instinct. He has really good meter gain because he has a projectile ender, or if you block them, his fireballs, even though that got nerfed, he still gets a lot of meter for it.
It's pretty ridiculous.
And they're like, oh, wow. They're like, wow, that's, like, really cool. You know, their eyes were opening up, and they're like, it's like Ryu on crack. And I'm like, but wait, there's more. Yeah, they were, like, eating it up. They were like, I'm about to buy this game right now. And I'm like, hold on. I'm not done yet. He has flip-outs, so he can flip you out and reset you in the air or in the ground. He has a trait where he can build his V-trigger, doing it around the world. If he uses meter, he does even more damage than before. He can combo off of grabs. He has Street Fighter, Cross Tekken, Fireball cancels. He has good 50-50s. And a bunch of other things. And that's when they were just like, their mouths didn't move anymore. And they're just like, why? And I'm just like, I'm not done yet. I'm not done yet. And then they all sat down and I sat down and I was just like, in his V-trigger / instinct. And first off, instincts are freeze frames. You can make pretty much anything safe. V-triggers, God forbid you do that in front of me, you're getting punished. Mm-hmm. It's different. It's very different. His instinct is a freeze frame. So you could do like a DP. And 11th J, man, I read you loud and clear. Am I making him sound OP? He's pretty damn strong, dude. He really is. You have to see, that's the thing. I'm a player, right? Yeah, I'm the spinal guy, whatever, blah, blah, et cetera, et cetera. But you also have to see that I'm also a fighting game player. I play other fighting games as well. So I see things and I'm just like, damn, bro, that's not right. Or damn, bro, maybe they need something here, et cetera, et cetera. So back to Jago. So now that you activate this instinct, right? You gain plus frames. You throw double fireballs, meaning you get double meter gain if they block. He gains health if these fireballs connect. They also add a bunch of white health too. Not a lot, but substantial enough. It does pretty good damage. Because he can combo off of grabs, you mean to tell me that I can shimmy you in instinct, grab you, and do a shadow fireball and then into fireballs to gain meter and do gain health and do damage? Yo, I think the one Ken player, like, fainted by the time I said all this. They were like, there is no way. And I'm just like, this is just Jago. You want to talk about Wolf and General Rom and Spinal and Sadira? And I'm just like, the characters in the game have so many crazy things that it's awesome. But some of these things right now are a little too crazy. Just a bit. Just a bit. Like, man. Man.
I like, in the words of Sajam, and this kind of is a segue to kind of like the next couple of topics that we want to discuss while you're here, which is talking about the tournament scene and community growth, which is something you kind of just talked about. You're kind of explaining how Killer Instinct is to other players, which is what I want to kind of get to in this next question, but this question is kind of leading up to that. But I think it's safe to say that you and CD Jr. were like the dominant forces in Season 2. You were winning all the tournaments, and if you weren't winning, you were at least making top three. And we've kind of seen you really well in Season 3 as well, right? You're EVO runner-up. You've won a couple. Yeah, I think you've won a couple of tournaments in Season 3 as well and made top 8. You won in Northwest Majors. I know that for sure. Oh, I'll never get over that. Mm. Anyways.
I'm sorry.
So I think you're really, really experienced in the tournament scene. Like, you are, if there's a tournament happening, I'm pretty sure it's safe to say that you're going to be there. Your people are going to be seeing Spinal or Cinder or whatever, right? So you've kind of been there the whole time. You've seen how the Killer Instinct community has been the whole time in the tournament scene, online and offline. You've been all the tournaments in Season 2, all the tournaments in Season 3. I don't know if you were in, I didn't really know you all that well in Season 1, so I'm not going to front, but How do you think the scene has progressed as you've gone to all these tournaments? Have the players gotten better? Are we seeing still more of the same? Has there been any growth in the scene? Have you been seeing a new player rise up and make top 8? What are your thoughts on the tournament scene for Killer Instinct? Is it still rising, or is it just more of the same every single tournament?
Okay, so this is kind of a loaded question. So Season 1, because of personal issues, the only two tournaments I went to was East Coast Throwdown and EVO 2014. That was my first EVO ever, by the way. I think KI was so awesome, but it was so underrated. So underrated. Super underrated. Probably the most underrated it's ever been. Season 1. And it was hype, not gonna lie. Top 8 EVO, or even pools and stuff, it was crazy, man. There was a lot of upsets. There was a lot of cool things. It was pretty damn awesome, right? Until, sorry guys, I love you guys. Grand Finals, EVO 2014. Dude, I love CD Jr. I love Rico. If it wasn't for them, I wouldn't even be here right now. They inspired me a lot. A lot. Evo 2014 solely inspired me to take this journey, take this risk, take this step. When I saw Sadira versus Wolf, I was so scared, bro. I was like, man, this is probably going to be anti-hype. I hope not. I hope not. And then I turned around and I started noticing people were like yawning or leaving or taking the going to a bathroom break or just complaining that, oh man, this is kind of whack. I was like, oh, this is going to hurt the scene. I hope not, though. The game's good, I promise. It is. It's good. And then season two happened, right? And of course, you always have to consider that it was only an Xbox One exclusive, which also kind of hurt, right? Because, oh, I don't want to buy a whole console to play a fighting game. I'm like, I get it, dude. I understand. It's a lot of money. I get it. Season 2, you know, TJ first came out, busted. Maya first came out, busted. Riptor first came out, busted. Everything was busted. But then eventually things started draining out. And the top 8s, whether it was in the... Even the beatdowns, the 8-bit beatdowns were at all-time high. Like, 800 people watching an 8-bit beatdown? Zombie, if you're here, I love you, man. Still proud of you, bro. Doing your thing. Good stuff, man. I remember when the beatdown was only like 50, 80 people. And I started tuning into the beatdown. There was 1,000 people watching an 8-bit beatdown? That is insane. I was like, dude, the community's growing. That's awesome. That is awesome. Tournament scene, offline majors. It either steadily grew or it steadily stayed the same, but different faces showed up. Season 1, people left. Season 2, people gave birth to new people, etc., etc. Season 3 kind of did the same thing. Unfortunately, Season 3 is starting to, I guess, bore people from what I've seen. From what I've spoken to people don't like watching it. They're like, oh, this is whack. And that sucks. It sucks to hear, right? Because that's, oh, man, your favorite game is whack. Like, it hurts your feelings, you know? Like, hey, I like this game, right? Absolute Battle? As soon as I got to my, like, what was it? Losers Finals match? I started noticing that people were, like, already leaving. Because the crowd was divided left and right. People on the right started leaving little by little. Then I lost, and then they started leaving even more. And I'm like, man, come on. Arbiter Fulgore, like, is it really that bad to watch? I don't know. East Coast Throwdown was the same thing. Shout outs to my boy Dream Crusher. Top 8 started. We have a nice little crowd. We had a little corner, obviously, because of space restraints, things like that. When you go to a tournament, you have to take all this into consideration. You do. But in our little corner, I was like, yo, there's so many people watching this game. That's actually pretty hype. By the time, like, Losers Semis happened, it was all gone. And I looked at Dream Crusher and I'm just like, it sucks that the crowd died. And you don't want to see that. You don't want to see that for your favorite game. And then some players, obviously, they don't play KI, but they watch it. And they're just like, oh, how come this character can do this? How come this character can do that? What can you do to do this? What can you do to do that? How come no one uses this character? How come I never see this guy? This is the reason why I wanted to play KI, but then blah, blah, et cetera, right? People are getting turned off at what they're seeing.
People hated watching Maya and Conra in season 2.
They did, but they didn't walk away. They hated watching it, but they stayed to watch it. See what I'm saying here? That's the thing that's worrying me. Right? Even now, like when I played against Conra in season 2, it was exciting. Yeah, he was broke, but it was exciting because I'm just like, oh man, you know. I gotta play on point, and I can't let him start up, or else he's gonna die or lose or whatever. Like it was so intense. It was so intense that the best Conra player in the world stopped picking Conra against me because I knew how to beat him every time. So what happened? He started picking Aria, and then that's what got everything juicy, right? That's what got everything exciting for the tournament scene. Oh man, Sleep and Base are gonna play again. It's Counterpick City. It's like a Pokemon battle. Do you really see that now? Not really. Just stick with your guns, I guess, right? Some of the characters in the game now, like, you know, okay, so KI is very different, right, in comparison to other fighting games. You have to choose the way you end your combos. You have to choose your way to end damage. other fighting games, you're hitting them, that's your damage. Like, that's it. Like, you're getting hit. KI, like, some characters, you're like, should I go for this battery ender? But if I do, I sacrifice damage, but I sacrifice screen positioning or things like that, et cetera, et cetera. Some of these characters don't have to do that anymore. And it sucks. It sucks seeing that. And it's frustrating to play against as a player. It's so frustrating that even spectators are like, man, that's kind of whack. And then they leave. And I'm like, no, come back. Because the community is growing. From season 2 to season 3, the community grew. And thank you, PC gods. Thank you, PC people. There's so many new faces now. Mm-hmm. It is awesome. Do I miss the season 1 guys that don't play anymore? Of course I do. Do I miss the season 2 guys that don't play anymore? Of course I do. But that's what it is, right? Make KI great again. The tournament scene is still alive, but it's lacking. It's not even just participants anymore. It's even the spectator. Do people even want to watch this anymore? I hope so. I do hope so. I want them to. I love this game.
So, go ahead.
No. You go ahead.
Well, you just talked about how you kind of missed those people that dropped off going from season 1 to season 2, season 2 to season 3. And I miss those days as well. Like, I really enjoyed watching all these people from these other fighting games, or known for these other fighting games, playing our game, Killer Instinct. You know, Chris G, PR Balrog, and Filipino Champ. Low Tier God was playing it. Who else was playing KI? Freaking Sonic
Justin
Fox.
Justin Wong.
Sonic Fox. They were all playing the game.
That's super exciting. You're like, oh, man, that's like one of my favorite fighting game players, and they're playing my game. That's super exciting.
Yeah, that was really cool for me. And I overheard Chris G talking on his stream the other day that the reason why he doesn't play KI, or, you know, he's dibbled and dabbled it every once in a blue moon, but he was on his stream talking. Someone asked him about KI, and he's like, I don't want to play KI because I can't play it as a side game. There's too much complexity to it now. There's too many characters, too many changes all the time, too many combo breakers. And then, you know, Chris G, he's a multi-game specialist. He plays almost all the fighting games, pretty much. And
In every tournament.
And when he goes to play Street Fighter, he can just play it and not have to worry about, oh, crap, there was this huge patch that I didn't learn about. He just goes in and plays his character because nothing's changing for an entire year. So how do you feel about that? Do you think this game is just too hard or too easy to get into for people now? Or, like, what's the deal? Why aren't people trying to play this game? Do you think Chris G is right or what?
Honestly, I think it's exciting that this game had this whole evolution, like, when it comes to the meta. Just like, hey, whatever you guys did before kind of doesn't work now, so trying to fix it here, blah, blah, et cetera, et cetera. It keeps the game alive. It keeps the game fresh for the people that are already involved. For the people that are trying to get in, or for the people that have stepped away for a bit, it's very intimidating. It's extremely intimidating. It's like, oh man, you know, I played Orchid in season 1, and what? She has what now? She has juggles and grenades and things like that, and what? And it's scary. It's scary for people, especially if you play multiple fighting games.
That's how I felt. That's how I felt in Street Fighter 4. I could not get into Ultra Street Fighter 4 at the end because there's too many characters, too many. There was like, it's so intimidating to play the game at that point. I just like, I played Evil Ryu. I learned like one combo and that was it. I had fun doing what I could. I was like, there's no way I can take this game seriously or even try to be competitive in it, you know? And I feel like that same thing is kind of happening to KI in my opinion, where it's just too much for people, right? They just want to be able to turn on their game and play it.
Right. Some people turned off by the fact that maybe my setup doesn't work anymore, or my character is so different. Or sometimes people are just like, hey, I don't like staggers. I don't like flip outs. I don't like air counter breakers. I don't like this. I don't like that. It's fine. People have their preferences, but I guess that's why people were afraid to touch season 2 and season 3, right? Because all of these constant patching and things like that. But we get it. The games weren't complete, so it was needed. Imagine having broken TJ, Khan, Rob, Maya, Riptor the whole time. Dude, like, I would have probably just jumped off a building or something. Like, it was needed. It was needed to test the waters and be like, okay, here's a brand new character. They're really OP, but then we're going to tone it down little by little by little by little. Season 3 also did the same thing, but even less. And they announced it. They announced it before. I get it. I totally understand. That's why this big patch, whatever it is, it's scary, man. Will it really address everything everyone's not having fun with? Would it really address some of the character problems? Will other characters finally shine now? Will you see a general ramen top 8 not because you had to fight against 1,000, you know, certain characters? No. Hopefully we do see a general ramen because, oh man, this character is pretty cool. And this guy using that character is a pretty good player.
Mm-hmm.
Some people aren't used to that. Some people aren't used to playing a fighting game where it's just like, I'm going to hit confirm you now, but here I'm not sure if I'm going to break this combo or not, or counter break, or this or that, and it's overwhelming. I've talked about KI before in other podcasts, and Street Fighter players want to play this game. Some Street Fighter players want to play this game, right? Other players, Marvel players, Guilty Gear players, people are interested in playing this game, and the first thing that they talk about, and it's so scary to them, but it's so basic to us, is combo breakers.
Mm-hmm.
Combo breakers are like so, like it's like it brings so much fear to them. They're like, I want to play the game, but I'm so scared if someone breaks my combo. And I'm like, dude, relax. It's your combo's gonna get broken like 7 or 10 times in a match. Like, I guarantee you, just relax. And it's like, no, I don't know. I don't know what to do. And it's just like, how do we take that fear away from them? How do we welcome more people into this community? And say, hey, even though your main game is Guilty Gear or Smash Brothers or Street Fighter or Mortal Kombat, play this game and it's not going to affect you. It's not going to, like, change your mindset and things. Do you need a different mindset when you play a different fighting game? Of course. But is KI a little too much right now? Oh, this character can do what? Oh, man, what's this character doing? Whoa, this instinct. I don't even know what I can see on the screen anymore. Yeah, and maybe it is a little too much. A little over the top. Was season 1 like that? Not really. Was season 2 like that? It started to get like that, but it wasn't that bad. Season 3, some of it's like, oh man, this is kind of not fun to watch. And it's just like, I know, but just give it a chance.
Mm-hmm. I've definitely seen this in some games where
right.
It's really hard to, you know, like you said earlier, it's like, it's almost impossible to have a perfectly balanced fighting game. It's just not going to happen, right? But you can definitely get to the point where their characters can shine no matter what, you know? Who's tired of seeing Chun-Li and Nash and Akali and Ken and Street Fighter, right? Everybody. But that's just the state of the game right now. that's just what you're going to see because right. Those are the good characters. And why would you ever play any other character? Why would you play Geef or Fang when you can play Chun-Li and make top 8 every time, right? Same thing in
exactly.
Killer Instinct. Why would you play Kim Woo when Arbiter's in the game, right? Why would you ever play Kim Woo when you can play Arbiter? And that's the kind of stuff that they have to kind of address, in my opinion, is give this character
now,
a reason to shine.
Now, granted, these characters, no one's going to pick them up tomorrow and be like, I'm going to win a major next week because they're that good.
Mm-hmm.
Granted, yes, you do need execution, you do need practice, you do need to get your feet wet with these characters. But once you do, yeah, you'll definitely start shining more if you invest your time in these characters rather than other characters, right? And it's not even just that. It's also some of the hunger from some players. My God, right? I love that guy. That guy's one of the nicest people I've ever met. He didn't go to Absolute Battle. He lives like 5 minutes away. Hey, man, why didn't you go to Absolute Battle? Honestly, I don't know, man. I'm just not playing the game anymore. And I'm like that breaks my heart. It's my God, dude. He's like one of the best people to watch. Just like, oh man, look at this guy's wolf. You know, he's just a really good wolf player. Hype. Just like when Grimm stopped playing Jago or KI altogether, it was like, oh man, that sucks. Like, we don't want you to go. Things started happening like that. Oh, look, perfect example. Rico. Hey, Rico, how are you? You just popped in party chat or Twitch chat, right? His hunger, dude, I loved watching Rico play in all the tournaments. He used to kick my butt pretty badly, and he still does, but do I miss watching him play? Do I miss watching him see compete? Yeah. Why is that? Where's the hunger? Where did the hunger go? Is it part of the whole Season 3 thing? Is it part of the whole game change? Maybe. Maybe not. Who knows? Me, personally, my drive kind of died, too. Is it because it could be a lot of things though? Maybe because I do need a break. Maybe I haven't taken that break yet, right? from season one to season two, I took a break, but season two to season three, I jumped right in. It's just like, all right, season three, bam, another major, bam, another major, bam, another major. Like, and then I started making YouTube content. I started making rough sets and group sets and stuff. Shout outs to everyone who's done that, by the way. Hope you guys learned from all that. Maybe I am overwhelmed, right? Maybe that's the reason why I'm not having fun. But at the same time, I try and lean back and take a step back and see it from a different perspective. And I'm like, maybe that's not it. Maybe there's just some things right now that take the fun away. Give me the fun back.
Do you think money could be a factor as well? Because there was $50,000 prize pot for Evo last year, but this year was only $15,000.
Honestly, I'm very new to the FGC. I'm not new to fighting games. I'm very new to the FGC. Money is a super cool incentive. It's great. But is it the reason why I play a fighting game? Personally, no. I play Killer Instinct because I fell in love with it. Okay. I was a diehard Street Fighter player. And Ultra Street Fighter 4 just came out. The patch, all that stuff. And I'm like, oh man, this game is so awesome. Coincidentally, Killer Instinct also came out. And I completely forgot about Ultra Street Fighter 4 because of how amazing KI was. I was hooked from day one. I couldn't believe it. I don't have that hooked feeling anymore, and it makes me sad. But do I like playing the game? Yeah, I guess. And even that, I don't like saying that. Yeah, I guess. No, I remember when I was like, yo, you wanna play KI? You wanna play KI all damn day long until my fingers hurt? Bring that back. Make KI great again. There's a couple of things you can tweak, and obviously the patch is coming, so maybe they will be tweaked, right? We don't know. Mm-hmm. You don't know. Maybe you do know, LCD. You're Hollywood, not me.
I'm Hollywood. What I do know is that a single patch, no how small or how big, is going to solve all the issues that everyone's having for the game, right? Because everyone has their own problem with the game.
Of course. Whether it be
combo breakers or my character sucks, nerf buff. It's just there's no way to solve everybody's issues. What I can tell you is that Keats has been giving subtle hints on Twitter over the last couple of weeks about some things that are changing. And even today, he tweeted that Gargos is going to be less runaway-ish in this next patch, which leaves me to believe that...
Very exciting.
Which leaves me to believe that this is going to be a really big patch. Like, this could be like a going from a season-to-season type of patch. I think that's how big it's going to be. I mean, I could be completely wrong. I don't know. As you said, I'm not that Hollywood. I don't know any of the changes except for what's been tweeted out. But I've started this new hashtag of my own called Believing Keats because, like, I've been in stream chats. I go to Facebook groups. I go to the Twitters. I go to the Reddits. I go to the forums. I see everyone's opinions and... there's just been so much toxicity in the community lately about, you know, the game sucks, I'm quitting, I'm taking a break, this and that. But I feel like some people need some hope. Like, the game is going to get better. The things that you're having problems with the game are going to change, right? Because the community, the IG and MS have always touted about how they listen to the community. And if they are listening to the community, then they know the problems. Keats told me to my face that he's reading every single forum post on the Ultra Common forums. Right, no matter how big you are of a
God bless that guy, dude. God bless that guy. I'll read like two posts and I'm like, no, I can't do it. So I don't know how Keats reads all of them. That's
crazy. So if he's reading every single post, he's even on Reddit. I know Keats is on Reddit and Twitter. He's everywhere, right? So I think the community kind of underestimates how in depth what the developers know in terms of what we think they know and what we don't know or what they're listening to. So who knows? But they're also going to do their own thing, right? I mean, we've seen that. They're just going to change what they think is best, not what we think is best at the same time. So that's my little spiel on that. But again, it all goes back to this patch. This is a preemptive podcast talking about what we could see. Because, right, we don't know when this patch is coming out. It could be end of this month, next month. Who knows? So what we talk about on this podcast could have some influence in the future. You never know. One of the things that I've always talked about, and this is a question for you, is do you think the game is at a point where it could benefit or be more of a detriment to have another season, like a season four? Or do you feel like KI should just, you know, have a rebirth with a new sequel? And one of the examples that I gave was, like, remember when everyone was playing the game in season one? It was a brand new game. And Justin Wong is a good example of that. He loved playing KI. It was a brand new game. Everyone was jumping on the new game board. Like King of Fighters, everyone's jumping on the KOF train. But slowly that dies off. And
that game's awesome, by the way.
I remember when Justin Wong was streaming Mortal Kombat X, and he had like 20,000 viewers in his stream, and eventually he just stopped playing the game. Do you feel like KI could benefit from a sequel to bring that hype back? Oh, there's a new fighting game on the market. I got to go try it out. Do you think KI needs another season, or do you think it needs another sequel?
I think it needs a sequel. Actually, let's talk about that. Season 2? I thought Season 2 was pretty good. Towards the end, like the World Cup, whatever, right? Obviously, some things should have gotten adjusted, and I'm pretty sure they would have eventually. But if they would have left the game alone and no Season 3, I would have been like, I'm cool with that. I personally would have been, I'm cool with that. And then Season 3 was announced, and I was like, okay. You know, you guys know how to do your thing. It's fine.
I also enjoyed the end of Season 2. I felt like the end of Season 2 was the best the game had ever been. And then, obviously, you know, they got to spice things up by making a new season. Right. But, you know, everyone has a different opinion on that. They want more content, more characters. But do you really need a new season to add another few characters, right? So what's your take on
that? Thank you for saying that. Cause, dude, I feel the same exact way. If they would have added Arbiter, Kim Woo or Tusk or Rash and not have called it Season 3 and just like, hey, we're just going to add a new character. That would have been cool. I liked Season 2 the way it was. It was great. Yeah, obviously, there was still some things you can balance, but that's the thing, right? You can't perfectly balance a game. It's like something's going to tip and the other one's going to, you know, fall over. It's not everything's not going to be perfect. There's always going to be something. Season 2, the end of Season 2, including broken-ass Shadow Jago, by the way. Because Shadow Jago was a little ridiculous when he first came out, right? I thought the game was great. Like, was Kanra annoying? He was, but he was tolerable. Was Maya annoying? She was, but she was tolerable. TJ, all them, all the top tiers in Season 2, they were tolerable. They didn't have me roll my eyes at the Versus screen and be like, great. Right. Season 3? Okay, you know, let's see what happens with Season 3. Season 4? I don't know, man. I say, leave it alone. If you want to add new characters, go for it, dude. Spice it up. Make the game grow. But a brand new Season 4? Let the game rock. Do what you guys want, you know, do what you guys want to do. Hey, maybe even promote it, right? And if you feel like it's time for a new one, go for it, man. Bring the hype back. Yo, KI2. A new KI2 or something. You guys have been doing a damn good job. I'm not going to take that away from you. Balancing a game is super hard. But Season 4 might be a little overkill. But that's just me. Maybe some people want a Season 4. Maybe people are just like, I want a Season 4 right now. Actually, you were there. You were around that time. As soon as Aria dropped, people were like, I want a Season 3 right now. Like children. It was just like, you guys gotta relax. Aria just came out like, no, we need more characters. They got addicted to the whole 1 month character thing. And it was a new and exciting way to deliver a game like that. Usually you buy a fighting game or something. It's like, here's all your characters done.
I mean, take
Season
a look,
2 was, here's a brand new character every month.
Take a look at the Smash community, man. That game has continued to grow and it hasn't seen an update in 20 years. Or however long it's
exactly.
been.
Exactly.
Right? Marvel 2.
Right. That's crazy. That's insane. But I believe KI can do the same thing. Do I think we need a Season 4? No, I don't think so. I didn't even think we needed a Season 3, but we have one. Do you guys want to add new characters to Season 3? Go for it, dude. It's exciting. The roster is very, very interesting. They're all so unique and different. You don't have two. You don't have a Ryu, Evil Ryu, Ken, Akuma, like Sakura. Like, you have your characters.
Yo,
they're
Sakura?
Pretty damn cool.
Sakura for Season 2.
Sakura's. Yeah, that actually would be pretty cool. But, an entire Season 4, me personally, guys, I love you. No, thank you. Give me a brand new game if you want to work on something new. But, let this game rock, man. Let this game thrive a little bit. I wanted Season 2 to thrive. I thought Season 2 was great. You guys wanted a Season 3? We have it. Let Season 3 rock, man. Let it live. Let it breathe for a little bit.
So, what is your take on the survey that came out a couple of months ago? It was asking us about new characters, what we want to see, costumes and accessories. Do you think that stuff is possibly hinting at a Season 4, or do you think that could just be stuff to, as like DLC or something like that? Do you think they're just done with the game and they're possibly even working on a sequel as we talk on this podcast right now for like Project Scorpio or something. What do you think?
I wouldn't be surprised if they do have a season 4. I mean, thinking about it from a developer's perspective, right? Season 3, you had one original character, Mira. Which is beautiful, by the way. Mira's my favorite season 3 character, hands down. Awesome character. Retrospect, go to season 2. You had Khan Ra, you had Hisako, you had Agnos, you had Arya. You were like, damn, these characters are so cool. Good job, man. Iron Galaxy knocked it out of the ballpark. Omen, too. I know everyone hates Omen, but I personally hate Omen now. But Omen, like, his design and all that, I thought he was pretty cool, right? You know, oh, man, he's so whack with his, like, bear design. I thought he was kind of cool. So, you mean to tell me that IG was going to bring out season 3? Bam! Guys, we love the KI community. We're going to give you season 3, but we only made one new character? I don't believe it. I think we're getting DLC. You mean to tell me that in all of season 3, we got one brand new character? We got, what, 3 guests and everyone else was returning or something? Something like that. No, I believe IG has characters ready at the go. They just want to hype things up or just fix the game for now.
Joanna Dark.
I think we're getting DLC. Oh, yeah, you've been wanting her since, like, season 1, dude. I've seen all the Photoshop. You're pretty good at Photoshop, dude. But when it comes to season 4, nah, I don't think so, man. I think maybe we'll get DLC. It'd be cool if we did. And hopefully from there, maybe we get a green light at a sequel, a true sequel.
A true sequel.
Yeah, man. You know, start off with 2 characters and then, no, I'm kidding. But still, just a true sequel.
I mean, speaking from the history of this game, Double Helix made this game in a year. The season 1, they made the game
know.
In a year. That, so who knows?
That's the crazy part.
Yeah.
Right. That was the crazy part. What? Again, you know, I've been asked this plenty of times before in other podcasts. They're like, were you hype about KI when it first, like, launched or whatever? Or it first got announced at E3? I was like, no. I'm a Street Fighter player. Like, I looked at it and I was just like, oh, KI's back? That's cool. And then I, like, flipped the channel. Like, all right, let me go see something else. But then I played it and I'm like, I was so wrong about everything. The game is so good. So good that I left Street Fighter. It's crazy. I would have never thought.
Shout out to Double Helix for making a great base for the game. But that's really all it was. It was a base. It was Iron Galaxy taking over an engine that they didn't make themselves, that Double Helix made. And now they're just kind of patching all over all that stuff that they really... There's been a ton of stuff where I've had in an interview, even in an interview I have with Adam Isgreen, there's just some things that they can't add or change or take away because of just how the game was built from the ground up. And so I feel like some of those restrictions would be removed if a new sequel was to be made. Because Iron Galaxy could do what they needed to do.
And again, I think Iron Galaxy has done a great job for taking such a crazy task, right? Hey, we made a brand new game, but we gotta go. So here's a game.
We gotta go.
Like, here, adopt this baby real quick and take care of it for the rest of its life. It's like, oh man, I wasn't ready for that, right? It's big. It's big to do. And they did it. They did a damn good job. They brought us fresh new characters and they gave us interesting new ideas to spice up the game a little bit and fix the broken stuff from season 1. And then season 3 came out and they tried to spice it up a little more and fix the broken stuff for season 2. But did they spice it a little too much? Maybe. Is this their plan all along? Probably. I wouldn't be surprised. I see you, Keats. I see you, man. I know how you roll. You never know. But they did a good job and they're continuing to do a good job. It's just, I think it's time, man. I think it's time to fix the little trinkets here and there. Obviously, nothing's going to be perfect, and maybe they'll keep on fixing later after this supposed, you know, big life-changing patch, right?
Life-changing patch. I love it.
Yeah, man. You never know. Boss Spino, please. Thanks.
Yo, what if Joanna Dark's in a patch with DLC or something?
Would be interesting. That would be interesting, right? It'd be pretty cool. Obviously, you're going to have the typical online trolls and be like, I hate guest characters. I'm like, well, guest characters sell the game, so people probably be pretty hype if they ever saw Joanna Dark. Maybe they wouldn't. Who knows?
Yo, the only reason I bought Combat Pack 2 for MKX was because of Alien. So, shout-outs to guest characters.
That's great, because now he's what, like the best or something?
He's the best character in the game.
You did the right thing. You did the right thing. But yeah, like, Iron Galaxy, you guys did a damn good job. Double Helix, thank you again for giving us the base, right? Do I believe in you guys doing a true sequel? Yeah, of course. You guys are doing your best. You guys actually talk back to the community. You guys actually hang out with the community at events, at Twitch chats, right? You got people here from, like, Iron Galaxy, just like, hey, what's up, guys? And I'm like, oh, you're watching my little ass stream? You know, like, they're just cool people like that. And we should be grateful that people respond on the forums and people talk to us about things and things like that. Because, you know, do other developers really do this? Not so much. No, not like this. Maybe some developers will tease something or troll something or, oh, they'll tweet about one thing or whatever, try to hype up a game. But these people talk to you. These people talk from player to player, casual to casual, business partner to whatever. These people are personal with you, and they talk to you and be like, hey, man, you ever play KI before? And it's like, no. Just like, well, you should try it sometime. They give you a controller right there and then, and they're like, hey, you should try this out, try this out. Here's combo assist, blah, blah, et cetera, et cetera. People are so harsh, right? It's the internet, and it's 2016, and people troll so much nowadays. People are so harsh to criticize. I think Shadow Lords is dumb. I think Combo Assist is dumb. I think blah, blah. Like, dude, they're trying to grow the game, bro. They're trying to make this community better. Kind of have an open mindset on some stuff. Combo Assist is cool for people that have never played a fighting game before. That's another thing, too, that people seem to forget. Because KI is free to play, and it's been out for, what, 3 years now, I think? Or 2 years? I don't even know. This is a lot of people's first fighting game. So they're not used to these mindsets. They're not used to, like, oh, man, this character's so OP. And they're, like, staring at, like, Kim Woo. And I'm like, she's not OP. She's good, but she's not OP.
Kim Woo? Can I get some Ming Lee's in the chat? Sorry, go ahead.
Shut up. But people aren't used to that. People aren't used to, like, oh, man, this guy teabagged me online, and I'm so heartbroken about it. Like, no, like, it's a different mindset if you played a shooting game or an RPG or, you know, other stuff. You come from different backgrounds as a gamer. Or I've met so many people, they've never played video games before, and they chose KI to be their first game. That's pretty damn awesome. That is awesome. So Iron Galaxy, obviously, they have to take that role and be like, how do we please everyone? And obviously, you can't please everyone, but how do we at least try to? They've been doing cool. I'm just hoping the meta changes. I'm not happy with the meta. I haven't been happy with Season 3 for a while, personally, but that's just me.
So
do I like making content? Do I like talking to everyone from the community and stuff? Yeah, I do, actually.
I think
do I like watching other Spinals play? It's awesome. I still cheer for him, right?
I think that's kind of what keeps a lot of us going. I think, I mean, I know quite a few people. I mean, I'm not going to name any names, but I know quite a few people that just haven't liked Season 3 at all. But the reason why they just keep coming into stream chats and hanging out with the community is because, you know, they're passionate. They do like the community. They do wish the better hopes for the game. They want the game to improve or the community to improve or tournaments to improve. Why would I waste my time doing any of this if I did not care? I'm not here to crap on the game or crap on the community.
Exactly.
I'm here because I feel like, what can we do? We need to talk about this stuff, because if nobody talks about it, then nothing's ever going to improve, right? And so that's kind of the perspective that I have on things, which is why I'm doing this podcast. You know, I'm trying to get another perspective, which is why you're the guest. Maybe I'll do another one of these and have Rico or Paul or someone in Filament, someone influential in the community, you know, give their thoughts on what's going on. But again, everything's about to change with this patch. You and my problems could both be solved in this patch that's coming up. We don't know, but we're going to find out pretty soon here. Last but not least, like I said, Season 3, it is what it is, right? We just have to either accept it or kind of just move on, right? And I want to know what you would like to see change specifically about Season 3. Not anything like getting into character specifics, but just general changes. Like, what could make this game better? What could make a person like Chris G come back to Killer Instinct and make him play at a tournament more than once? You know, what could make the Joe Schmo from King of Fighters come try out Killer Instinct? What could make a guy like Grimms or PR Balrog come back to KI? What do you think is going to happen in Season 3? Or should?
Honestly, man, honestly, make it fun again, man. Like, there's a lot of things that just turn people off visually. Sometimes you look at a game and like let's say you have no idea about KI and someone does instant cancel into some crazy stuff and it looks all insane. Like people are like, what is this? And they walk away, they get turned off. You want the game to look cool, you want the game to look solid, and some of the matches, I should say, right? Some of the matches you see, you're like, this doesn't look fun. Or like, like that doesn't look hard to do, you know? Like, oh, this doesn't look like fun, blah, blah, this and that. Bring that back. Bring it back. It was fun, man. It was cool.
I'm going to interrupt you here for 1 second because I'm so glad you mentioned that, because I feel like appearance is a huge thing in a game. So many people have complained about not being able to see anything on the screen because of RAM's instinct or something like that, or they don't like the way a person's hair animates or something like that. There's so many visual things that people don't like.
Kim Woo's face?
Nobody likes Kim Woo's or Tusk's face. I mean, they gotta fix that stuff. I mean, I talked to somebody who said, I don't want to play Season 3 because Tusk is ugly. That's really bad. You should not have people not playing your game because this guy's appearance is bad, right?
I'm not even surprised. That's like the dumbest thing I've ever heard, but everyone's entitled to their opinion, but I'm not surprised.
I'm not even kidding. This is what I was told.
Right. I'm not surprised. I'm not.
They got to fix that stuff. I don't know if it's budget issues or what, but they got to make room for a budget to go back and redo some of the animations in the game. I definitely agree, but you can continue.
You want the game to look a little more welcoming, right? Like Marvel, for example. If you've never played Marvel versus Capcom before and you watch a high level match, you're like, I don't know what just happened. Some people think it's awesome because there's like beams everywhere and it's all flashy, and some people are scared. They're like, I don't want to play that game. Like, why? Just like, look at what just I don't even know what's going on anymore. That. Especially people like Chris G, Justin Wong, you know, PR Balrog and stuff. They go to these tournaments. They travel across the world for fighting games, right? What will make them consider making time for this game again? Make it more approachable, more accessible. And it would be great because it would grow our community and it would spice things up. These players are super strong, super intimidating, super strong players, right? So like if they were to come back and be like, hey, you want to play like a first to 10, or you're their first match in tournament, you're exciting and you're like, oh man, am I fighting Justin Wong right now? That's kind of crazy, right? You want that excitement. You want communities to combine and just either grow each other out or more. And KI is lacking that right now. KI, you look at KI season 3 currently right now, and it's just like people roll their eyes and say, oh, you know, that's dumb, or oh, that kind of looks boring.
That's dumb.
And I right, and from a casual spectator's perspective, we get it. From a casual perspective, like some people like the things they see, like, oh, that's so awesome, that's cool too. But right now, it's like steadily declining. At least from what I've seen, from the tournaments I've gone to, and from the Twitch chats that I watch, and the streams I watch, right? Like, let's talk about the beatdown again. Remember how I said, oh, there was like 800, 900 people watching an 8-bit beatdown? I haven't seen any as of late because I've been busy with my life and things like that. What was their peak number before, last time? Why is that? Could be a lot of reasons. It could be the game itself. Bring the flair back. Actually, no, the flair's there. Tone it. Tone it so that people could be like, oh, man, this game's awesome. And then there's that, right? The community did grow. It did. We got PC, we have Xbox, and it's cross-platform, and you only have to buy it once. Dude, that's super awesome. And also, as much as you're trying to grow the community, as much as you're trying to obviously, you know, have KI a household name, and like, oh man, you know, I want everyone to play, you also don't want to be blinded